Hello guys, welcome to another session of consolidation. Now we'll be looking at the income statement or profit or the statement of profit or loss. Income statement, consolidation of income statement. It's me again, Marvin. Let's get started. Just like when we're doing consolidated financial position, I'm gonna go through all the theory. Then the next or the part two of these slides are gonna be for calculations only, but these ones are for tutorial or theory. So when you complete this chapter, we should be able to let me get my pen right there. My pen. Yeah. When you complete this chapter, we should be able to describe the components and consolidating the comprehensive income for the two companies, subsidiary and a parent. We do so by doing what? One, by eliminating intercompany trading balances, excluding cash and goods in transit. Remember, these two, we dealt with them on financial position consolidation, under consolidation of financial position. So here is not part of income statement. So forget about goods in transit and cash. We should be able again to remove unrealized profit arising from intra-company trading or trading within the group. So, and also the acquisition of subsidiary mid-year or mid-acquisition, how to deal with the consolidation in any time of the accounting year. It's a very short topic and simpler than financial position, as there are very, very, very less adjustments or workings. So the consolidated income statement shows the profit figure generated by all resources disclosed in the consolidated statement of financial position. Remember, it is the assets which generate income, or the resources which generate income. So don't be shocked by seeing the way financial position when we are dealing with the income statement. Okay? Yep. So there are principles for consolidating income statement. Like we're saying, the two company can trade with each other, maybe the parent selling to the subsidiary or the subsidiary selling to the parent. Therefore, revenue will be triggered or will arise, okay? So, from revenue to profit for the year, you should include all parent income and expenses, all 100%. Anything for parent, include the figure 100% of it. Don't try to apportion it. 100% of it, plus all subsidiaries' income and expenses, reflecting control. In other words, if we have acquired 70% of the stake in subsidiary, so we're only going to get or consolidate expenses and income after applying the control percentage of 70% or whatever percentage, if the admin expense is 100 for subsidiary and it's a 50 for the parent, you're gonna say 50 plus, this is for the parent, right? So this 50, we take it as it is 50 plus this 100 times 70%, okay? 70%, because we only control 70%. Therefore, it's gonna be 70 plus 50, which is close to 120, I guess. This is close to 120. Then our admin expenses are gonna be 120, consolidated admin expenses, okay? Okay, so after profit for the year, we should split the profit. We should split the profit attributable to parent shareholder and non-controlling interest. Remember, like I just said, we only take 70%, okay? At the end of the year, or after setting up the income statement for the consolidation, we add line by line. But the very, very last line, we need to split between controlling interest and non-controlling interest. How are we doing so? We will take the profit figure for the subsidiary. You multiply it by the non-controlling interest, which in this case is going to be 30%. You multiply it by 30%. Then the remaining, which is the balancing figure, will be profit attributable to shareholders or to the parent or to the group. Okay? We'll see how this is done. I know now it might not make sense, but we'll do it on the part two of this video, where we'll be doing calculations. Yeah, I have introduced you to the mechanism of consolidation. No need to touch it, but let me just go through it. When we're doing financial position, We said with the structure. The structure, this is whereby you determine the control. How much or by what percentage is the parent controlling the subsidiary? The net assets of the subsidiary at acquisition. This is required, especially when calculating goodwill. So you cannot or you can never ignore the net asset calculation and also the goodwill calculation. The goodwill calculations, which will be used to calculate goodwill, of which sometimes there might be an impairment element on it, of which impairment is a loss which will be taken to consolidated income statement at the controlling percentage. At the controlling percentage. Okay, so under consolidation, we might find that the subsidiary is paying dividends to the parent, because the parent, remember, parent company's shareholder is a major shareholder, therefore they might be paying dividends to the subsidiary on whatever basis, maybe annually, quarterly. Yeah, so this dividend should not be included in calculation of, or should not be included under consolidation. It should be cancelled, should be removed. But only dividends paid by the parent to its own shareholder somewhere else outside the group. That one can be shown on the statement of consolidation. Only if it's is the subsidiary paying parent, you not include it. But if it's the parent paying the third party or the outside shareholders, then we include it. Any income shown in the consolidated income statement must arise from investments other than subsidiaries. Just like I just said, even in dividend paid should be dividend paid. Pardon, dividend. Yeah, dividend paid should be dividend paid by the parent to the outsiders. Okay, even subsidiary paying should not include it. But here, like they're saying, any income must come from any other investment other than subsidiaries. That one is eligible to consolidation. It should be consolidated. I think this one is very clear. No pain, just a gain. So like I was saying, just like in financial possession, in profit or loss, there is also intergroup trading. Intergroup trading, sales and purchases between the companies. So the effect of intergroup trading must be eliminated from consolidation. Just like at the profit or loss or at the financial position, we were eliminating intra-company trading. Such will be included in sales of one group, of one party of the group, and the other will reflect as a purchase in other group, other part of the group. Like if the parent or if the subsidiary is buying from the parent, it means under parent is going to appear as sales, under subsidiary is going to appear as purchases. So we need to eliminate that. Okay, so under consolidation, the revenue, we take parent revenue as it is, 100%, subsidiary, add the controlling interest, then you will less the intra-group sales or transactions which happened between the two. Okay, you will less it. Same as cost of sales, because purchases are part of cost of sales. That's why we adjusting cost of sales. You add, remove intergroup sales, then you add unrealized profit. You add it back, which was generated by the sibling company selling to the other company, or the family, or the parent selling to the subsidiary, or subsidiary selling to the parent. So we should eliminate any profit gain by such party. Elimination of intergroup sales, the general entry for that. Sales is sales revenue, remember? It's sales revenue. So sales is an income. So sales normally occupy or have a credit entry. So if we eliminate, it means we reverse. Therefore, we will capture opposite. Therefore, the opposite is going to be what? It's going to be a debit, like you are seeing here. Sales are debited when we are eliminating. As for cost of sales, the purchases are expenses. In other words, they are costs. So they had initially been debited. As we know, in the trial balance, purchases are debit. But when we eliminate or when we reverse the intergroup trading, we credit. Simple as that. If you know the traditional entries for the element, you shouldn't have problem with this adjustments. What you should know the original entry of each element, so that when you are eliminating, you just simply capturing or entering the opposite of what was done at first or initially. Okay, so we also have to eliminate unrealized profit, or the profit which was gained. Oh, I'm sorry, before I go there, There is this important note here. This adjustment should always, always, mark my word, always, 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 always be made. Either the goods still remain on the inventory or not. As long as there has been sales between the two companies, they has to be reversed. Okay? Let's now get back to the unrealized profit. Unrealized profit, we eliminate it. Remember? Like I was saying, unrealized profit, it arises when one company sell to the other company within the group. Within the group. So it means that the company may have made profit by selling to its sibling or the parent to subsidiary or subsidiary to the parent. Okay? So what happens is that the inventory for the company which purchased, it will have the profit which was charged by the seller. So the profit will be part of the cost of the inventory. So inventory is debit, is a debit entry, right? So we want to remove that that profit element from it, which is part of the cost. So if you want to reduce that cost by limiting the profit, it means we have to capture opposite, which is credit. That's why the inventory becomes credit entry here. Okay? It becomes credit entry. I think it's a simple math. It's simple math. So the corresponding entry will be cost of sales. The very same figure which we take here from the inventory, we take it to cost of sales, of which it will be under, what is this? So you debit it. That way, you have simply reversed everything. We have reversed everything. So in part two of this video, we will be doing calculations demonstrating how all the things are done. This one is very simple. So make sure you get the concept, the theory, before you watch the next video, the part two of this video, which is calculations. Then I'll give you assignment afterwards. Till we meet again next time, my name's Marvin. I'm out.